Europe is that those people who have been living in cantons and they're unable to alienate, they have alienated themselves from the rest of the society. So radicalism was easy to grow, and that's why we saw so much of influx of mercenaries coming from Europe, around 12,000 people, or only came from those area, poor area, criminal backgrounds and all. Now the Syrians are able to adapt themselves there, yes, but there are, the problem here is that there are more than people now coming and calling themselves Syrian. You have Pakistanis, you have Bangladeshis, you have from North African state, everybody saying they wanted to use the humanitarian issues in Europe as a pretext to enter into Europe. And now the third, which is most important here, how do we know that among these people are not a terrorist people, have been enjoyed and smuggled inside to create havoc in Europe? What will happen tomorrow if a radical element within this group go and blow up himself somewhere? Then you are creating instability in Europe. So there is a crisis in Europe, not only the demographic changes, there is also a crisis of instability, and there are people who are countries maybe interested, those who created the war, to create an Islamophobia in Europe. And you are having failing government and failing nations in Europe, where they are having the problem now of their economic crisis, and country after the other become bankrupted. There is also an emergence of the patriotic and the national party at the cost of those people who are rejecting those right-wing people who are, Professor Shazi was mentioning in Germany and all. All these people have been now coming up in the open to oppose this kind of crisis, or this kind of receiving the refugees. And when I went to Europe, for example, I wanted to go to Warsaw, I had to go to Austria. I was stopped at the airport, checked my passport, scrutinized it, and then they have kept me for some time till they checked with the government of Warsaw that I am coming there, and then I was allowed in. Now can you imagine this type of thousands of people are on a border, you open the border and they are in, they don't know what their background is, you have no people start putting on Facebook and social networking, this is a criminal, he killed somebody in the country, you please follow him, don't let him go in. So there is a crisis going to happen in Europe, and Europeans have to tackle it. It's not a matter of 200,000, 300,000, it's a matter of the public in Europe also, which they are going to face the music with their government, and they show more resentment against their establishment, why this crisis has been happening, and what is the best solution out of it. So Arab, maybe Syrian, Lebanese, they have been adopted. We had the catastrophe 100 years ago, you know, in 1911, Syrian Sykes-Picot division of the Arab world. We had the Ottoman Empire, where they have made equal number of refugees in the world, Syrian, are equal to the number of population currently. We have 23 million Syrian in Europe and Latin America. Why? Because there is a political reason for this. So, you know, when you create a war, you have other reason to fill the bucket of this greedy world, but you're forgetting that there is the land with people, not people without land. So I think this is the issue, has to be dealt with Europe in very detail, especially the public of Europe, because the future of Europe now is at stake, I would say, not only because of the crisis, because of the economic crisis also, because of other religious issue which is going to be erupted in Europe in the coming months.
Ambassador Rangachari, I think this is a very, very serious issue, because it certainly poses a great challenge for the European countries here, especially the ones who are grappling with a bad economy. And, you know, about Germans, it has been said that they're already taking down the burden of the Greek crisis. And, you know, there are other issues too, which may not figure out now, but in a short while from now, if this influx continues at this rate, I'm sure those things are really going to come up.
But I want to go back to the question of, you know, I mentioned the numbers in the last segment. Yeah. Therefore, to focus on Europe, when in fact the total percentage of the immigration into Europe, or refugee flow if you prefer to call it that, is only 20% of the total intake that the European Union is getting. Now, whereas the much bigger problem in terms of numbers and at a human level is in the countries concerned themselves. So we have to not lose sight of the fact that countries like Syria and Iraq, where there is an ongoing war and so on, and then the other neighboring countries, the effect on them of the war. So the first thing to do is to address the problem back home in these countries and try and fix that. And if we go back in history, problem largely started because of the attempt to try and dislodge the existing regimes in Iraq and in Syria. This goes back a certain period of time. Today, the consequences of those are coming out in the open. To what extent now it will be possible to put Humpty Dumpty back together again, one doesn't know. But that is one aspect which should not be lost sight of, because today Europe is the target of a large number of people going, but still the numbers are very small compared to the totality of the displaced persons in the region itself. That's number one. Number two, for Europe this is not a new situation. Again, if you go back, the Office of the United Nations for High Commissioner for Refugees was created precisely to deal with the refugees post-war in Europe.
Yeah.
It was not an office which was created in order to address global problems,
right?
Because at that time, in 1945-46, only 50 countries were members of the United Nations. The rest were colonies and they were dependent territories, etc., and so on. So this is not a new problem for Europe.